Hey guys, welcome to the G2 Esports Class Legend Tournament. I'm pretty hyped. I can't remember when I was that hyped about a tournament for a long time because we are introducing a new format. And with me is the one and only Soddle. How you doing, man?
Yeah, I'm doing good. Thank you. Thank you for noticing me immediately. That puts you...
Yeah, I can even... I'm not sure if that's the correct... correct direction I'm now looking at, but I'm trying to look at you.
Good enough. So, yeah.
Now I have 100%... like chance of actually looking at you for a second, so here you go.
Points for effort, at least. Yeah, but like I like to echo your sentiments. I'm very, very excited for this tournament. I think the innovation that people are putting into new formats in Hearthstone is really exciting. It's one of the great things about card games, I guess, really, is that we can invent all these ways to play ourselves just because the game is just kind of this big sandbox that we can create our own rules for. So
yeah, and that's fucking amazing. Sorry for the, you know, swear word, but I guess we can be more casual today, right?
Sure.
It's early in the morning and Anna is not watching. We have EU viewership today, so you know, but it, like as you said, card games in general have that kind of unique open game design that allows you to do that kind of stuff that we are now doing today. This format that we'll be using today, we'll explain it in a few minutes, is something I wanted to try for a long time, but no one from the organizers wanted to be the first person to actually do it, you know, because the Hearthstone is so different from other card games when it comes to hard counters in cards, and there's no real way of sideboarding, that making a one class tournament seems like just a peculiar thing to do, and it's not easy to pull off. So this is first time someone is actually doing a one-class tournament, and let me explain you the rules, because they're pretty simple. First of all, each of the players will be playing only one class. So they pick a mage, they pick a paladin, they pick 15 times paladin, or, you know, there's other class. And that from that one class, you build two decks. They don't have to be different. You can play one deck twice, but there's no point in doing that, right?
Yeah.
So you build two decks, which are 30 cards each, and then you queue up into a best of five. No decks are being eliminated. So if you win a game, you stick to your deck. If you lose a game, you can replay your deck or switch to the other one. The idea here is that when you lose a favorable matchup, which can happen in card games, you have that second chance to redeem yourself, right? Because that's something that you would have in real life card game, right? Because you sideboard, you have the second chance, and you can try to be better in the matchup that you would have or you should have won in the first place, right? So, and if on the other hand, if you lose a unfavorable matchup, then you have a second deck prepared that you can counter, or at least try to counter, the deck that you lost to. And it's all about preparations here.
Yeah, that's one of the cool small twists to this format that I really like. Obviously, the single class format is the important thing, but the fact that you're allowed to requeue a deck that you've lost with is really interesting to me, because we've seen, you know, historically when Last Hero Standing was our competitive format, it very, very often came down to sort of the game one pick. Mm-hmm. And then whoever won that, you'd just get counterpick, and then the series would end up 3-2. And even in Conquest now, there's this element of like the first player to win an unfavorable matchup just takes the whole series, just because of the way that the format swings. So being able to queue up a deck of your choice, even if it's the deck you've already lost with, should mean we get some more exciting series. We get closer series. I'm expecting a lot of 3-1s and 3-2s and very few 3-0s in this format. And so, yeah, I'm just really excited to see what people come up with, and really excited to see what classes people pick, because honestly, I have no idea what I'd go with.
Yeah, that's something. I mean, that's also like we picked some invites for the tournament that should be, those people should be comfortable with a certain class, right? And we'll start off with Zetalot against Stan Sivka. So I guess Zetalot plays Priest, right? I have no idea about Stan Sivka, because he's a really overall good player in almost every single class, right? But Zetalot is known for playing Priest. And I'm really interested in to see if he picks that class because he's comfortable with it, or he picks something else that he thinks it's more powerful in the format. Like, I really want to see how many paladins will be there from the 16 players. If there will be like 15 paladins and one priest, or it will actually be different, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Zerlot for sure is obviously a very accomplished priest player, but the thing with him and priest is that he has played hundreds, if not thousands, of different builds of priest on stream. Primarily known as a ladder player, doesn't have too much tournament success, and primarily when he plays ladder, he plays priest. But what his huge skill is with the class is being able to change three or four cards here or there just to adapt a control priest deck primarily to any given meta that's presented to him. So this sort of format where he can just, you know, pick two of those decks that he thinks will cover the meta is very, very appropriate to him. So I certainly think he will bring priest. The issue that he's going to come up against is that he has to accurately predict the meta of the other 15 players in the tournament and find some way to beat that with just two priest decks, which may not even be possible. I don't know.
Yeah.
But yeah, we'll wait and see, I guess. But like, hugely surprised if Zerlot doesn't pick priest it.
That's true. Like, I would be really surprised too, but we also didn't talk about like how the bracket works. It's pretty straightforward. 16 players, single elimination. It's like a typical invitational tournament. As I said before, we would really love to have an open tournament in this format, but it's impossible for now to do it like fairly because of the amount of interface options that you have to do to make on your own side to do like the deck lists to somehow check up on players if they actually don't cheat, right? In an invitational with 16 players, that's actually easy to do because everyone will be broadcasted, everyone will be using those decks and we'll see them on screen, and we have the deck list submitted. So, you know, there's no way of being unfair to your opponent. But in an open tournament, unfortunately, this format would be a no-go for now. But we'll try to pull it off for the future because if, of course, this format will be a success. And I hope so, because I would really love to see more one-class tournaments.
Yeah, again, just I love seeing the innovation that's come out recently. Obviously, we've seen the Team Sealed format that there's been a tournament for recently, the Red Bull event, and obviously people are experimenting a little bit ahead of time with Standard. So yeah, this sort of experimentation is definitely a healthy thing for keeping Hearthstone alive in the long term. Obviously, we're getting these two new formats coming into the game officially. You know, one is the competitive standard and then wild mode, sort of retaining the mode that we have now. But there's no reason why we as a community can't invent our own ways to play and keep the game growing and blossoming with new ideas like this all the time. So hugely excited.
Yep. And we'll be starting soon when the players will be ready. And now we know that we have the classes confirmed, so maybe.
Okay.
Subtle, can you tell me which classes are picked?
Yeah, so drumroll, Zetalot is in fact playing priest.
Whoa! Huge surprise.
So the slight mystery here is what was Stan Sifka going to pick, and Stan Sifka has gone with warlock as his class, which you said, you know, Sifka is a very well-rounded player, plays a range of decks, but I think if we were going to pick one class that he's well known for, warlock would probably stick out of that. He's had a lot of success with Handlocks and Reno Locks in tournament. Hit rank one legend with the one of the first innovations of the Fugan Stalag build of Reno Lock. So seeing him bring a warlock to tournament is no huge surprise. I think warlock is kind of just the big elephant in the room for this tournament as well, because it's such an easy class to play in two different ways that are completely polarized that cover different matchups. You can just build a control warlock of whatever method you like and then just bring Zoo. The question I have, though, is will Stan Sifka even have brought Zoo? Because I can't remember really seeing him play the deck too much.
I would say that he played Zoo in one tournament, if I recall correctly.
Okay.
But that was like a very heavy druid meta. Like a very, very heavy druid meta. So it was a metagame answer than I would say, comfortable pick.
Right.
But yeah, I would put him on every control version of Warlock, which is also like Stan Sifka is known for being a poker player and a Magic the Gathering player, right?
Yeah.
And it's also very interesting to see when someone is transitioning from other games, from other card games to Hearthstone, they usually pick Warlock.
Right.
And why? Well, how do you think? Is that the hero power?
Yeah, I think it has a lot to do with the hero power, because most other card games, stuff in your hand is more valuable than it is in Hearthstone. For example, in Magic, cards have much more initiative from your hand. They're quicker onto the board. They do things straight away. Whereas in Hearthstone, a card in the hand is almost worth nothing until you paid the mana to develop it. So one of the big obstacles people have to overcome when they transition to Hearthstone is getting their head around the concept that card advantage isn't everything. I've some friends of mine who are really good Magic the Gathering players, I've seen them transition to Zoo, and they'll just like tap on turn two instead of playing like Knife Juggler, and they're like, well, now I have like seven cards in my hand, this is awesome. It takes them like a few days to like get their head around the fact that it's all about initiative and tempo, and Hearthstone is a much more tempo focused game than a lot of other card games. So as you say, a lot of card game players do tend to gravitate towards Warlock. Stan Sifka no different. But we'll see if he's able to throw in the curveball here and bring out the Zoo.
Yeah, that's very interesting. I mean, probably we'll see one version of Reno Jackson Warlock, right?
Yep.
And maybe then more control-ish version, like a more answer-centric version of Warlock against a control matchup, right? Because Reno Jackson Warlock is, in my opinion, is kind of like a great answer to aggro decks usually, because you can use the different type of minions to achieve the same thing, because usually you have just a taunt minion, right? For 4 mana, you have Ascension, which is a great drop if you play like a Palter Shredder and Ascension.
Mm-hmm.
It works fine both ways. But when you want to win against control decks more convincingly, then I think like Warlock should be more centralized around answers to minions, around Big Game Hunters, like maybe a Malagos Warlock, right? An example.
Sure. Yeah.
Something like that. So I'm very interested which decks they will choose to go with. And they will be both opening with the deck B. I have no idea if there will be a difference for us, right? Because it's A and B for both of them. And usually there will be no difference, but we'll see. So it will be something really interesting to see. And I have no idea if one match will be lasting like 10 minutes or 90 minutes.
Right.
Because
We don't know what the decks are.
Yeah.
I guess the last talking point here. Well, there's two. One, Zerlot's Priest. He's famously not a fan of Dragon Priest. So he says he finds it boring and it's just, you know, play minions on the board, and that's not really what he wants to do in Hearthstone. So he may, like I mentioned earlier, just bring two different builds of Control Priest teched in different ways. And then the other thing we kind of need to talk about is just the matchup we have here. Historically, Control Warlocks against Priest is one of the most one-sided matchups in the game. It's not quite Freeze Mage Control Warrior level, but when you're a Priest and you queue into a Warlock, you're begging for them to drop a Flame Imp. If they life tap on turn two, you feel like you're in a world of trouble. So if Stan if Stan has brought the two variations of Control Warlock, that might just queue up extremely well against Zerlot's lineup, especially Lothar, if the card Jiraxxus is present in them.
Just wanted to say and then try to use his catchphrase, but never mind. But it's very interesting to hear, but like, you think this metagame might be aggro-ish? Like, if everyone will play at least one aggro deck? Because I think it's viable to bring two versions of the same aggro deck to have like different kind of answers to certain strategies. Like an example, let's say someone picks two face hunters, but one is very centralized about face damage, so plays additional projectiles, and the other version will be about removing taunt minions, right? And maybe this is something that will be, you know, used, but I have no idea. So there's a question, open question.
Indeed. So it looks like we are straight into game one here, and we do have Control Priest versus Control Warlock here. Putting my money on a Reno Lock from Stan Sifka, but not entirely sure yet. And we do see straight away Elise Starseeker is in this deck from Zetalot, which is a decent answer to these sort of very, very slow control-y decks, like the Reno Lock.
Yeah, I have a problem. I don't see the screen right now.
All right, Lothar. It's fine. I got this.
Okay, I'll try to fix this.
So, decent initiative start here from Zetalot. Nausea Cleric and Wild Pyromancer just curved out onto the board. This is one of the ways you want to go about beating a Control Warlock, is just get a decent amount of early pressure down. If he drew it into a circle of healing here, he would have been able to make a huge card draw play. He can still do something like that with Power Word Shield and heal. And since he doesn't have anything to play onto the board, no curve 3 drop to play, it looks like that's the play he's going to go for. Picks up a second Orcanai here. We see he's carrying Light of the Naru in his deck, as opposed to the more usual at this point Flash Heal. Zealot has been known to play 3 individual healing cards in his Priest decks, though, and play 2 Flash Heal and 1 Light of the Naru, so we could be looking at that deck here. Stan Sifka chose not to play his Imp Gang boss on the previous turn, just scared of the initiative he could give to the Cleric to draw some cards. But now, since the Cleric has been Power Word shielded, it then locks him out of his turn 4 play as well. He can't drop the Void Caller onto this board for the same reason. So it seems unlikely that he'll continue to pass much longer. He'll probably just have to suck up and face the fact that he's going to let his opponent draw some cards here. And the Void Caller will potentially summon Jiraxxus to the board, though, which is something that Sifka will want to avoid here, just because of how powerful Jiraxxus is. Normally, getting a 315 on the board is a huge benefit, and passing up the Jiraxxus Battlecry is very, very worth it. But against Priest, that card single-handedly wins game, so he will want to activate Jiraxxus Hero Mode in this game, which may be enough to convince him not to play the Void Caller, but after long deliberation, decides to play it out here anyway. Circle of Healing drawn, which, now I've lost it as well. So Circle of Healing was drawn, which connects pretty well with his 2 Orcanai Soul Priests that he had in hand. Those Orcanai represent a lot of value in the long term, because he also has Light of the Naru that he can use for a tempo play with the Orcanai. So we'll be seeing what he can do here.
They're trying to fix the, screen share, because I couldn't even join Sotol right now with the casting. Sorry for that.
This always seems to happen to me once, but I always end up solo casting one game in every single cast that I do. I don't know. I apparently just curse broadcasts. You shouldn't have me on anymore, Lothar.
Yeah, well, I can just go away, right? And you can do it all by yourself. But anyway, I'm interesting. Now he's sitting.
Hey.
Okay, yeah. Now it works. Okay, so what's happening? Elise is already on board. Interesting. Okay.
Yep,
so I'm trying to catch up with.
Yeah, it looks
what's
like
happening.
The Jiraxxus was summoned from the Void Caller, which, you know, it's hard to say Stan Sifka is sad about getting a 315 for free, right? Piloted Shredder drops a 315. That's not too bad.
Yeah, that's not too bad, but at the same time, Zettel will be kind of happy about it, right?
Right, exactly.
Because that's the win condition against a Priest, like, immediately. If Stan Sifka just drops it on turn 9, he most likely will win the whole matchup just by the sheer power of spawning 6 minions each single turn for 2 mana, because there's no answer to that, and the weapon itself gives you so much board advantage that it will just keep on piling on, and that's something that Priest can't really keep up long term, right?
Right. Yeah, exactly. And the other factor as well is that 15 health against Priest might as well be 75 health, as much as, you know, Priest can actually deal damage. So you just have so much longevity to keep generating 6/6s every turn. But he's going to try and get some work out of his 315 here. The nightmare, of course, is that Zetalot's deck had Shadow Word Pain in it, which just immediately nukes the Jiraxxus off the board. But he's dodged that bullet, at least for now. And he's going to be able to get a little bit of value out of his 315 going forward. But as you mentioned, Lothar, the win condition is gone.
Yeah, and there's 2 entombs in Stan Sifka's hand, so he can actually get the Jiraxxus for himself. And that will be an interesting turn of events, right? If he gets the Jiraxxus into his deck, he will draw it, and he can turn the advantage the other way around, right? Because the Warlock will have a problem, like almost the same problem, as the Priest to deal with those 6/6, right? Because there's only 1 Shadow Flame most likely in the deck. That has the option to kill those big minions.
Right, absolutely. Twilight Drake, again, another one of Priest's natural enemies. I was just wondering whether Stan Sifka might be desperate enough to take the nuclear option on his Jiraxxus and actually like make the Shadow Flame play there to prevent the Entomb. After seeing the Priest draw so many cards, you're pretty confident that he'll have an Entomb in his hand. But he's going to go instead and generate a lot of pressure on the board. So if the Priest here does spend his whole turn on Entomb, at least Stan Sifka is relatively far ahead on the board thanks to that extra Twilight Drake. But there are a couple of strong options here. He doesn't have to immediately entomb that Jiraxxus. As long as he gets it before it dies, he'll be relatively happy. It's like it's a huge threat on the board as a three power minion. So he could choose to just make a swingier board play, a more immediately fast tempo play by using the Cabal to steal the Imgang boss this turn and just save entombing the Jiraxxus for a following turn. And it looks like that's the play he's going to go for. And I like this a lot, Lothar. What do you think?
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Like, you it's a spot-on analysis of what happens in the game. I don't have anything to add up after that. Like, really, spot-on. And it's really interesting to see what will be the answer from Zanzika, because, as I said before, the Shadow Flame is the only option for him right now to answer a board, right? And he needs to queue that up at some point in the game, but seeing how much Zetalot has cards in his hand will make a problem to queue that up in a correct turn, right? Because if you do it too early, your opponent will just replenish. We'll just play another minion, new minions on board, and you will have the same problem because you can't really use Hellfire right now.
And
there's also like the fact that you didn't see a single Light Bomb, you didn't see a single Entomb yet. And all those cards will punish your board heavily if you play that Molten Giant, right?
Indeed. And still passing up the Shadow Flame here, as you mentioned. He's trying to find just the perfect time for that. He's going to continue to get a little bit of value out of his minions. But as you said, just staring back over at that Priest hand of, what's that? I believe that's actually 10 cards now. Did you realize? Yeah, that's 10. He has to feel like there is a Light Bomb and an Entomb. Like, with this many cards in hand, Zetalot is well within his rights to have one of each of those cards. We see, in fact, he actually has two of each. So he has answers for days right now. But yeah, he has to make some sort of play that isn't too devastating against Light Bomb. And the dropping the Molten Giant here makes Light Bomb very, very appealing.
Yeah,
he can choose to answer the Jiraxxus or the Twilight Drake as well to get caught in the Light Bomb by using his minions. But it's not going to be a complete board clear here.
What do you think about just playing the map this turn? Like, how much damage can your opponent dish out next turn, right? If you don't use the Light Bomb this turn? You think that's something that you might be able to risk?
I think it's a consideration for sure. The problem is there's above 15 damage on the board, which means that he can represent two-turn lethal with Lowertheb if that's a card that's in his hand.
So
he can just immediately push for pressure, play Lowertheb and Taunt on something, for example, and just be threatening to just take the game with two-turn lethal. And wow,
That's actually Handlock.
Yeah.
Handlock. Two Molten Giants. It's the first time I see that for like half a year or even more.
Yeah, I mean, obviously this is the tournament where you're likely to see some more niche decks, and this kind of gives pay to the theory that he might be bringing the two different Warlock control decks. But actually, I could have spotted this a little bit earlier, because he drew the second Void Caller a few turns ago as well.
And the second Sunfield Protector, right? But at the same time, people are using so much hate on big minions right now in the metagame that maybe we couldn't predict that there would be a typical Handlock in the lineups, but it's very interesting to see that that Stansifka chose to use this type of deck in this particular format, right? Because it's so different than Ladder, so different than a usual Last Hero Standing on Conquest. So very interesting to see the old stylish deck that we are not seeing. Oh my god! A sacrificial pact, and this is very interesting, because you know you will be always playing Warlock every single time, right? So you can always use it on your demon, but if you want to use it offensively, then he is anticipating that people will be bringing more Warlocks, right? Because that's the only reason I see to bring a sacrificial pact in your own deck,
right?
And this also blows my mind that in this format you can actually have that in one of your decks, because you can queue that up against a Warlock, right? But needed.
Oh, the interactions we're seeing in this format already. So, an Imp Gang boss that was stolen by Cabal Shadow Priest spawned Imps, which were then eaten by Sacrificial Pact from the Warlock player. That's fantastic.
Yeah. Awesome. This is really awesome. So now, second line, wow, the combo.
plays the Acolyte just to generate the card draw off it, and it's worth noting that Zetalot is actually not far off lethal here with the Orcanai Soul Priest, Flash Heal, Light of the Naru hero power combination.
Yeah, that's awesome. And
he's really, really close. How much damage is that? 6 plus 5 plus 2, so he has 13 total damage right now. If he can get his Justicar down on a turn before that, he adds 2 more.
I think that's the play next turn, to play Justicar and just have that 4 damage burst, which is insane against a handler, because then you turn into a powerful hunter for a turn.
Right.
It's like double the hunter hero power for 2 mana, and you just drop a minion, and then you have kill commands for 1 mana, which is like insane.
Yeah, and Sifka, looking at his hand and just how these next few turns are going to develop, he doesn't have too much of a way to play around this. He has Loatheb to potentially lock out one turn, but now that life tap has brought him into range. I think actually that's just lethal,
that's it,
right?
That's the it, because it's 13, locked, right?
Wow. Double Naru, heal hero power.
The Hunter Priest. That's really cool to see. Like the amount of projectiles he has in his hand with the Hunter hero power just makes it so oppressive against a handlock.
Yeah, that's just crazy. I mean, Sifka would have considered the Orcanai Soul Priest. Of course, it's one of when you're in such a favored matchup as Warlock is against Priest, you play around your really, really niche outs, right? You think, okay, what's the one way I'm going to lose this game? But in that situation, he already used one Orcanai, so he had to have Orcanai. He had to be playing 3 burst heal cards, and he had to have drawn all 3 burst heal cards in that hand. So insanely unlikely scenario to come up, but that's kind of what it takes for Priest to be able to beat a Warlock in that sort of situation. It's exactly what Zetalot had. And he's going to go out to a 1-game lead here.
Yeah, I mean, now that will be another peculiar choice for Stan Sifka. What does he have as the second deck, right? Is it something different than the Handlock? Will it be better against the Priest? Because now he knows the deck has 2 Light Bombs that Zetalot has. 2 Light Bombs. He didn't see a single Shadow Ward dev, but he saw 1 and 2, if I recall correctly.
Yes,
right?
1 and 2, yeah.
And he saw the insane amount of bursts possible if there will be an Alcanai drawn, right? So that changes the matchup completely, because you can't be so certain that the Paladin can't burst you down from the moment when you drop a Molten Giant. Mm-hmm. So that, or you drop just Draxxus, and you're still in a possible range of being dead in one turn.
Yes, indeed. So it looks like Sifka has just re-queued the Handlock here.
It appears
to be exactly the same deck. We see Molten Mountain and that Sacrificial Pact that we reacted to last time, and this is the scenario you spoke about at the start, Lothar, where Sifka says, okay, I was not supposed to lose that matchup. This is a favorable matchup for my deck, so I'm just going to go ahead and re-queue the same Handlock deck here. And hopefully I can restore the natural balance of the world and pick up this win.
Yeah, exactly. But it's interesting also to see if that will work, because I think the Priest with a decent draw might be really have an advantage over the Handlock here, because there are so many answers: Shadow Ward Dev, Entombs, Light Bombs, and those Death Lords are not that easy to remove. If there will be a single answer to the biggest minion that can Warlock drop on turn 4, which is the big Mountain Giant, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And I just want to comment, I think this is a really high-level play from Zetalot. He saw Imp Gang Boss in the previous game, so he's chosen to play his Acolyte of Pain here. Not only is he threatening spells from the Pyromancer, picking up extra value, but he's also punishing the potential turn 3 play of the Imp Gang Boss by preloading that Acolyte to draw additional cards. So very quickly identified the slightly weird twist on Handlock from Sifka, including the Imp Gang Boss. Slightly more common in the Demon version that Sifka is playing, but instead of playing the Death Lord here, he drops the Acolyte of Pain, and it creates a very awkward situation for Sifka, locking out that Imp Gang Boss on turn 3.
Yep, that's good analysis, as you said. It's also a very interesting interesting bluff, because when you have a Pyromancer and an Acolyte on board, then you might say, I have a spell for next turn. What spell is it? Is it Shadow Ward Dev or the Mountain Giant? Do you want to risk a Mountain Giant into a spell that would generate also a card advantage, right?
Sure.
So that required an answer for the Pyromancer first.
Yeah, as it turns out, he didn't have any spells in his hand at the time, but he actually just chain drew into two power word shields, which would have been an insane turn if the Pyromancer and Acolyte were remaining on the board. Each one of those power word shields essentially replacing itself with two new cards. So works out very well there for Sifka just to dark bomb down the Pyromancer. But the Mountain Giant has come down here. There's no answer. As you said, we have not seen Shadower Death from this deck yet. So that Mountain Giant is going to be able to challenge that Deathlord very, very quickly.
Wow. I love that attack into the Mountain Giant. Because you know that there will be silences in the deck.
Right.
There's Hellfire won't kill the Deathlord anyway. So the two attack will be very important just to deal the damage to the Mountain Giant. Wow. And a 4-1... That's actually, I think, the worst possible draw apart from Owl, right?
Right. And even then, like, sure, if you get an Owl, it's weaker on the board. But you know, the Twilight Drakes are so valuable against Priest that just losing one of them from your deck to come out as a 4-1 is probably significantly worse than just getting a 2-1 Owl onto the board. So that is pretty devastating for Sifka here, and he's going to have to find some way to remedy this situation.
Mm-hmm. And now this is... Well, he can play Defender of Argus just to buff the minions, but I think like the silence is very important just to deny the card draw possible for Zedlot, because he thrives on answers in this matchup, and if he doesn't get them, then he will just be burned by the amount of power on board, right? And this is exactly the scenario that Zedlot is in now, because he didn't draw a single Light Bomb, he didn't draw a single Shadow Ward Death,
right?
And now he's running dry. What do you do in this situation? There's nothing. There's practically nothing. You can double draw if you attack into the Owl with your Cleric, and that's probably what will happen.
He's going to draw, I think, four cards here off the Blade Mask. No, he doesn't have the extra mana for the Light of the Naru. And he was punished a little bit for drawing Light of the Naru there instead of Flash Heal, just by having that card in his deck. With the Flash Heal, he would have been able to snipe down that Mountain Giant from behind the taunts, but Light of the Naru, not quite enough reach to pick it up. So he just picks up the double draw, digging through his deck for those answers, like Entomb, like Light Bomb, etc. But for now, the Warlock is probably going to continue the procession of big minions here. He's tested for Light Bomb, I think, with that board. But the one niggling feeling in the back of Sifka's mind is that his opponent has just drawn a lot of cards. So there's no guarantee that the Light Bomb still isn't there, even though he will have. It feels like he will have tested for it pretty well on the previous turn.
Yeah, I guess that you just go all in. You just don't care. You don't care about the Light Bomb, right? In this situation.
I like it. I think just like playing the Emperor here is reasonable. Emperor or tap Twilight Drake. Both of them aren't too bad against Light Bomb. Emperor at least brings some value to your hand, and Twilight Drake, of course, just naturally resists the Light Bomb due to the shape of its attack and health. And so I like this play a lot. And wow!
Oh my god! I love this actually. You know that this is, if Zedalot is low on answers, then he has no way of removing those minions, right?
Right.
But, and his draws will be really, really bad if you basically destroy almost every single possible way of drawing cards, because he used two clerics, he used two power ward shields, so how many cards can draw him cards anyway?
Yeah, that's a really good point, but still, the discipline and the respect to send 8 damage into a Nausea Cleric there. But yeah, you're right, Sifka appreciates that now that he's eliminated the card draw from the game, that his hero power as a Warlock can just easily take this over. The Priest is unlikely to draw every single answer now just by drawing one card per turn.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they do... the Warlock hero power can just keep refilling on threats, especially since Handlock is an even more threat-heavy deck than something like Reno Lock, you know, where you're just playing the single copies of all your big threats. You know, this has the double Molten, the double Mountain, the double Twilight Drake, the Void Callers, etc. There's so many proactive threats in this deck that you're unlikely to see an answer to all of them from Zedalot, especially now the card draw is removed.
Yep. Very good point. And now... Oh! Mal'Ganis?
Mm.
Well, there's two Void Callers, right? In Sifka's deck. So probably that's the reason why he's running a Mal'Ganis in a Handlock deck. So what did he remove? Because usually that's not the pick that you have in a handlock. You have Sacrificial Pact here and a Mul'Ganis. So what would he cut?
I mean, there's a lot of flex cards that you can move down to one-offs. We saw double Sun Fury Protector, so it's not that, but I would suspect he's playing one or zero Defender of Argus. He's also fit in the Imgang boss as well, which is another card, so we might be looking at him cutting an Owl, cutting a Mortal Coil, something like that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Probably just playing a few one-offs, maybe going down to just the two AoEs as well, one Shadow Flame and one Hellfire. In more of a Reno style. Handlock's a pretty flexible list that you can tech out in a lot of different ways.
Yeah.
But not something that we've seen a lot of recently, though, because of how powerful the Reno lock has been recently.
And now Zedala is in a situation when he needs to ask himself, how do I win this game? Because
mm-hmm.
he's in a really bad spot, and if he needs to be really aggressive and needs to go for a high-risk, high-reward play, which is to set up a potential lethal with the second Alcanite, like the way he won the first game, right? That's the possible win condition, only possible win condition in the current state of the game. Otherwise, you can't really count on anything else. You can't use the flash heal to kill a minion unless it threatens your existence in this game and just kills you, basically. So it's very interesting to see what will Zedal do next turn.
I totally agree, but this Mul'Ganis is going to accelerate things very, very quickly here.
Ooh. Well, Light Bomb from the top of the deck would be really cool.
Yep, and we know there are two of them in there, but as we say, Zetalot is out of ways to draw additional cards, so he needs this draw right here. That's good enough.
He can kill the board, but then he loses the possible way of winning the game. So what do you think about just playing Acolyte and Elise and wait?
Ooh, okay, so Loetheb has been pulled. So that last time you brought up this kind of play, that was my concern, that if Loetheb was dropped, then that would just end the game. But since Loetheb has been pulled out without mm-hmm. the Outcry here, it's actually a little bit more appealing. I don't hate that play, and it looks like the line that the Zerlot is going to take here. And if this is the line that Zerlot is taking as priest, then round of applause for Lothar, because that probably means it's the right play.
Well, this is something that a lot of players are not considering while playing in a tournament or while playing even ladder, that you need to count your outs.
Yeah.
And how do you win the game if you just use all your cards to survive? There's no way of winning the game afterwards, so I think that's a correct turn for Zetala, just to get that one Light Bomb to still have the chance of winning the whole game this time. But Arabic Owl will shut down a lot of hopes.
Yeah, and I love that Owl from Sivka. He recognizes how desperate a play that is from Zetala. He knows exactly what's up there. Just trying to cycle through his deck to pick up the Light Bomb that he doesn't have in hand right now. So the silence on Light shuts down some dreams. And
now this is the turn when you actually need to play the Alcanite,
yeah.
Unfortunately.
Either way, I mean, the game is not over, but this is pretty much GG at this point. He's going to be down to one card in hand if he chooses not to play it. It might be even down to zero if he loads up the Pyromancer afterwards. But there is just no win condition here. He's behind on life. He's going to be 8 or 9 cards behind on resources in a bad matchup to start with. So this is going to be a huge struggle. Zerlot is going to have to chain sort of back-to-back 6 or 7 perfect draws in a row here, which I don't think there are even 6 or 7 perfect cards in his deck anymore.
Yeah, good point. Good point. Flash heal on himself. Wow. So he's going in. He's still going for that. No, he's not. Never mind. I really thought he's going for the for the Light Bomb next turn, but he would have been dead anyway. So
yeah.
It's not possible. But now he has 0 cards in hand, a 3-1 on board, and a dream. But that's about it.
The dream is quickly evaporating as well. it's not a nice dream. It's not a pleasant dream.
He needs a lay on hands right now.
He does, yeah. Wow.
Well, this looks kind of ugly from the priest perspective, right? You're staring at a warlock at 16 health, which has full hand, and usually this is the turn when you play in a. if you play in a tournament that has a timer for a round, this is usually the turn when you just conservate the time for the games and just concede right away.
Absolutely. But Zerlot is searching for his out here. I'm not sure he's going to find one, but it looks like he thinks his out is dealing 7 to face this turn.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Oh, no, he's going to go for the clear. Yeah. He is going to go for the clear. Okay. I thought he was going to go aggressive and just put the 7 into face, but I was struggling to see how that ends up with a win. Of course, I'm struggling to see how anything ends up with a win here, but Zerlot continues to go for the ball control line here, and I guess he's just... he's on the plan of just drawing back-to-back light bombs and entombs and keeping himself in this game for as long as possible.
Yeah, but that's not possible at all, as we know, because Stansivka can even just play Void Callers and pressure him with 3-4 minions that that are resilient to light bomb, and even if they die, they will drop something from the hand. So, what do you do then? There's no way of winning the game anyway. Wow, a golden monkey. Now, what do you do? Never mind.
Yeah, so Zerlot casts Wild Growth that turn, draws a card. The card that he draws, unfortunately, is a priest card, so not going to have a huge effect on this game. Light of the Naru, not going to get him anywhere, and looks like Jiraxxus is just going to come down here.
It's a heal for 4, right?
Yeah, heals for 4, pushes 3 extra damage, but more importantly, now he has unlimited threats, and there is no way that Zerlot can draw enough answers to deal with these.
Hey! Here we go. So, I predict that because the Light Bomb was really needed this game, he will have 2 in his opening hand next game.
Yeah, seems legit. But I guess what Zerlot is doing here is just staying in the game as long as possible, seeing how many cards he can scout out from his opponent. Because, of course, even if win or lose, your opponent still has the opportunity to queue up the same deck. So getting information on as many cards in their deck as possible is very, very useful. So I don't blame Zerlot in just trying to scout out as much information here as possible.
Yeah, but Stansivka will not fall for that, right? Because he's an experienced player, he would just use the same cards that he was using last time, and I'm sure that Zerlot will not use the Shadow Ward Death. There's no point in doing that. You lost the game, you know that, and you didn't... You didn't show the Shadow Ward Death for whole 2 games. So it's very important to consider that information from Stansivka.
Yeah, absolutely. Great play from both of them on those last 2 turns. Just the little tournament meta of concealing information in your decks. Stansivka made the absolute minimum play to put pressure on board, just generated a 6-6, played a Sun Fury, didn't really play any additional cards from hand. Then, as you pointed out, Lothar, concealing that Shadow Word Death for later in case he wants to queue up this priest deck again, which, of course, due to the tournament format, he is allowed to do, even though it's been defeated. And we're going to have to see whether Zerlot has a better answer for Handlock than that double entomb, double light bomb priest deck that we just saw.
I think he had a really poor draw at this game, right? That was... It wasn't really appealing as a priest, even if you play against an aggro deck, because the 2 Deathlords, they're okay against aggro decks, but in general, they were not helping in this particular matchup at all. He didn't have 2 cycles, and... Yeah, he was just having a really bad draw against any kind of controller's decks. I might think that he will reuse the deck. So, yeah, they're actually both sticking with their deck B. So my guess is this is the best matchup they can play.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems like both of these players are actually happy with this matchup as far as their lineup goes. Zerlot doesn't feel like he has a better... priest deck to deal with this, and we saw from Stansivka after he lost the first game that he just requeued again, feeling like he should have the favored matchup. But as you said, the double early Deathlord draw there was kind of awkward for Zerlot. They can be useful in heavy control matchups, but you want to draw them later. You want to play them like the turn before you're about to light bomb, just to pull extra value out of the deck that way. So we might even see him mulligan away the Deathlord here, but with the Nausea Cleric, he might use it just as a wall to generate some early healing. It looks like that's what he's going to do.
Okay, but he needs to attack into something.
Right.
And that's the problem, because if your opponent has an 8-8 minion, usually it won't survive the attack, so he can't really cycle through it.
So
wouldn't you hard mulligan, for an example, let's say Shadow Ward Death, or the 4-3 orc that damages himself, that I just forgot the name.
Injured Blade Master.
Injured Blade Master, exactly. Yeah.
I mean, we have seen Imgang Boss and Void Callers from Span Sivka's deck, so there's a lot of plays around turn 3, turn 4 that this Deathlord plus Cleric combination will interact with quite favorably. It just double Sacrificial Pact!
What?!
Okay.
What is happening?
Why would you on Earth play two Sacrificial Pacts in a one-class tournament?
He must just think everyone is going to bring Warlock. That's the only explanation, right?
Yeah, I think so. Because it's kind of useless against other classes unless you want to heal yourself. Of course, that's the reason to bring double Imgang bosses in his own deck. Because that's the demon generator, right?
Yeah.
He doesn't use Implosion, I think. So he has to rely on that Imgang bosses. It's really interesting to see. I'm like...
It really is, yeah. It's like, potentially maybe this is his anti-aggro build of Hanlock. So he has the Imgang boss for some early board pressure, and then if the Imgang boss is allowed to stick and start generating imps, he has all those zero mana heals to start pulling him back 5 health at a time. And it also has the added benefit of just nuking any other control Warlock deck as soon as they play Jiraxxus.
My god! Well, the Deathlord is something that can backfire heavily, and a turn 5 Mal'Ganis is something you don't want to see at all. My god.
So the play here, Lothar, is Sacrificial Pact your own Mal'Ganis to assert dominance in this matchup.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Sanzifka will be like, yeah, I'll win this anyway. Here you go. I'll just kill my own minion. I'll just cycle through the deck, you know. Wow. This is painful. Like, and there's no Light Bomb again. No Light Bomb again. There's the Entomb, but it's far away. As far away as Light Bomb, actually, because it's still 2 turns away from 6 mana.
Right.
But it seems so awful for Zedalot currently. Fortunately for him, there's... Sanzivka has to sacrifice 2 cards to deny him card draw, and that's all... Of course, that's something that he will do, because he was doing that for 2 games in a row, right? He sees the potential value of drawing cards for Zedal, because he needs those particular answers to the big minions. If he doesn't draw that, he just immediately loses against the Warlock.
Right, and I believe he is now 1 damage off a board clear here with the Orcanized Circle Light of the Naru. He will leave the... giant around as an 8-1 after that point. So it looks like he's just going to try and set this up over 2 turns. And this doesn't telegraph Organized Circle. I don't know what does.
Well, now we'll see a Defend of Argus just to prevent that Flame Strike, right?
Right. Even then, like, one of the minions will go down to the hero power, but the other one will survive. Argus, tap Argus seems totally reasonable here. And just push a whole bunch of damage.
Well, you don't even lose life.
Right.
It's like... Yeah, I just spend 2 mana, get 1 card for free. And I have a 9-4 minion on board for 0 mana. Sounds cool. It's like 5 innervates. So...
looks like he's considering the Imgang boss here, which does play around Orcanized Circle a little bit, because he'll start generating the 1-1s. Obviously, the Imgang boss will be buffed by the Mal'Ganis effect. But I'm with you here. I think the Defender of Argus and just push a million to face is the play here.
He plays around Light Bomb, as he said. But so those are the mind games that sometimes you will see the pro players are doing, right? He thinks that Zedalot is bluffing with the Circle Feeling for the Light Bomb? I don't know.
I mean, yeah, that would be some really high-level stuff. Obviously, there is a tendency for casters to recommend plays based on the perfect information we have of both people's hands, but I think that was just such a clear telegraph of Orcanized Circle that you could just afford to make the most aggressive, punishing play. Because he would have pushed 2 extra damage with the Defender of Argus. And then he would have kept a 9-1 in play afterwards.
Yeah.
So you're just threatening lethal over 2 turns at that point. So.
I agree. But in this situation, Stanzivka has a perfect option anyway, because if he wants to use all of his mana this turn, he had the option of using the 1-1 just to kill off the Orcanized Soul Priest, right? And he of course didn't use that because he has double Mortal Coils. We thought he would be using 1, right, in that build.
Yeah, that was definitely one of the possibilities. We haven't seen two owls being drawn yet, so it may be one of the owls that is cut. And I'll tell you also, what we have not seen is Ancient Watchers. That is a card that is probably gone from the deck.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, he still uses double Sunfear Protectors and at least one Defender of Argus. Mm-hmm. But it seems like a viable cut for the Imp Gang bosses. Because it's almost the same value when you count HP and attack, right? You get 3 mana, at least 3/5, which can be proactive.
Sure.
So it seems very, very reasonable to cut the Ancient Watchers in favor of Imp Gang bosses, especially when you play double sack packs.
Yeah, absolutely. And especially with the additional synergy from the Void Caller as well. You know, you obviously you want to hit your higher value demons with the Void Caller most of the time, but just having those extra demons in the deck for insurance. You know, we used to see people play sort of one extra big demon at the top of the curve, a Doomguard or a Dread Infernal, that sort of thing. But Stan Sifko looks like he's gone for the Imp Gang boss to get those extra demons in the deck. But we are trying to find some things to talk about here, Lothar, because this game is just plodding towards what seems to be an inevitable conclusion. Again, it seems really, really difficult for the priest to deal with this flood of minions that's going to come down here.
Yeah, but again, sorry for interrupting, but again, Zetalot has the same problem as game 2. He didn't draw his cycle mechanism, or he used it just to draw 2 cards. Oh my god, what a heads up flame! Oh, that was cool.
He just won against those mobs that just dark form in the face to assert dominance. Okay, so sometimes you see that play to immediately activate a giant play, and that's one.
Yeah.
You dark bomb yourself so you can immediately play 2 giants. That was literally dark bombing himself in the face just so he can play giants at some point because he knows Priest is not going to hurt him.
Like, oh my god.
How the level of swag to that kind of play.
That is so disrespectful. I would say it's like. I really love to see a tournament when the players are facing each other without headphones and someone does that and talks to the other player, tries to tilt him, you know?
Yeah.
That would be so cool. Oh my god.
But okay, so just like explaining this line of play for people that haven't figured out what's going on, he has Jiraxxus in his hand. Jiraxxus is the immediate win condition against Priest.
Yeah.
He has double Molten Giant in hand.
And he can't play those after he plays Jiraxxus.
He doesn't want to play Jiraxxus until the Molten Giants come down. So that Dark Bomb to face is basically accelerating his clock. So this turn he can play out the Moltens. And then, if we get Light Bombed, we get Light Bombed. I'll just Jiraxxus. It looks like he's actually going down a slower line here and just playing one to play around the way. Well,
he can't really play into a Light Bomb if he plays double Molten Giants, right? He knows that there's no Light Bomb in Zetalot's hand, but let's say you drop both Molten Giants, mm-hmm. and then Zetalot rips it from the top.
Sure.
And it's like, I guess I lost one win condition, and I have to rely on Jiraxxus right now.
Yeah.
And what if there's a Fold Steal? Oh, no, wait, never mind. He has 2 Sacrificial Packs already in hand. So that's not possible, but that would be really cool to see.
I don't think it's going to happen this game. I don't think there's enough time left, but I would absolutely love to see Jiraxxus come onto the board from Voidcaller, get entombed, get played by the priest, and then Sacrificial Pact ends the series.
Oh my. Oh, that would be so cool to see.
How much damage are we looking at here? 15, 2 extra damage in hand from the Argus, or 3 from the Jiraxxus. We're still a little bit short of lethal here, but I think the lower Feb and make your opponent have to have an 11 mana light bomb seems like a pretty reasonable play.
Well, Defender of Argus, the Defender of Argus is just
5 mana left. I would expect Mr. Lower Feb is coming down right now. There we go. And this should pretty much just lock out the game.
Yeah, 11 mana light bomb is. Oh, look at that. It's actually being drawn. Right. Well, then Stan Sivka takes the lead for the first time in this match. It's 2-1 for Stan Sivka. Zetalot from SK Gaming will have a hard time now winning 2 in a row with a priest against a Handlock. I don't know exactly to name this deck.
Yeah,
right?
it's Handlock-ish.
It has the synergy, the basic synergy of Handlock, which is to abuse hero power and the Molten Giants and Mountain Giants at the same time. Like, that's the primary idea of the deck itself, right? But then we see some really cool tech choices. We have the endgame gosses, we have the two sacrificial packs, which had small use for now, but we'll see, maybe they will be more useful in the future. And Zedalus is first now, and I guess he would like to be second to have more options in his hand, right? To get more cards. Yeah. This is one of the situations when you actually don't want to be the player that starts the game. Look at that, there's a Force Seal!
Yes, and we just got the info that Zelot has now switched to deck A, which, surprise, surprise, is another Control Priest deck. But it looks like this version is carrying Thoughtsteal, which is an excellent card against Handlock for sure, just to be able to pick up some high-value threats of your own. But again, something drastically different has to happen here, because Sifka just has the Handlock. He's in the comfortable position here of just knowing he's queuing into Control Priest over and over again, one of the most favorable matchups in the game. So Zella is going to have to make something pretty big happen here to swing this game around.
Wow, he is really unlucky with those Death Lords. He has always them for the turn three, but I guess this is the one of the times when he will not play them. Would you favor the Fault Steal just right away to maybe have a... Well, actually, that's nothing you can play from the Fault Steal on turn four. Even if you draw a Mountain Giant, you are not able to use it right away. Ha! Interesting.
Wow. Yeah, and a really, really good, very interesting decision from Zetalot here. Just with that Orcanine in hand, he's really valuing having the board clears available to him, so he chooses not to circle up this Blademaster. Obviously, it would just end up getting contested by an 8/8 Giant anyway, even if he did make it a 4/7. Mm-hmm. But the punish was available in Stan Sifka's hand, which was the Dart Bomb.
Taking look at that. He's just playing the Orcanine on board.
Interesting. I mean, I guess he knows there's no way that this gets answered immediately on turn four. And for the first time here, Sifka actually misses on his turn four play. The Voidcaller just comes one turn too late with that Mal'Ganis in hand. Mm-hmm. So there is a little bit of initiative here for the Priest, but doesn't have too much to follow it up on. But now he's a solid minion ahead of the board. He might be able to take this turn to Thoughtsteal and perhaps pick up some more options or some more answers for the following turns.
Wow, but it is not looking good for Zedalot. I mean, he really needs good draws for the next three turns or amazing Fault Steals. And there's still one Sacrificial Pact in Stan Sifka's deck.
Yep.
So if he gets the Sacrificial Pact from the Fault Steal and he's able to deal with the Mal'Ganis without any investment, right? That seems very good. But that's like, I'm guessing Stan is at 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, at 19 cards. In his deck. Mm-hmm. So you will have 2 out of 19. Well, 2 out of... I'm not exactly sure what is the mechanic. Does it draw at the same time? Or does it draw, like, one other time? So the chances might be different, right? But there's a huge chance to draw the Sacrificial Pack next turn.
Yep. Looks like he's not going to go for the slow play here with the Thoughtsteal. He's just going to go for maximum initiative, try and rush the wall.
Oh, and there's the dream gone.
Second Sacrificial Pack comes out, but there are still some good draws from the Thoughtsteal in the deck. Big Game Hunter would be a nice pickup, assuming that's in the deck. I believe we've seen
that. We saw one.
Yeah. Jiraxxus would seem, in theory, to be an excellent Thoughtsteal, but we know that would just end the game if he Thoughtsteals Jiraxxus. But there's a lot of good options in there to get still, but the lower third play here, basically locking down his entire hand, he would have liked to Thoughtsteal that turn with nothing better to do. Lowerthed blocks that out, and Zetalot actually chooses to continue the aggression instead of trading into the Lowerthed here.
I really like that, because he knows his options. This is something that he was doing for the past three games. He can't really spare the damage. He knows that he's either going ham, or he just loses the game instantly. Like, his win condition is being face hunter this game. This is something he did game one, and he won that. So that was very important. Very important decision to make. How do you win the game? How do you win the match in general?
Right. So Voidcaller does now finally hit the board. We see that it's... he did draw Endgame Boss that turn, so it's not the guaranteed Mal'Ganis summon anymore. And he's there a lot with a nice on-curve Cabal Shadow Priest here just to keep up the pressure. Not too many great targets in the deck for Cabal Shadow Priest. Of course, Endgame Boss has been added, which is one of the very best Cabal Shadow Priest targets in the game, but... Zelot choosing not to be greedy here, just playing the 4/5 on curve while he can. And I really like this play. It's very consistent with the line he's taking, which is just making the most aggressive board play on every turn that he possibly can. And now having that flash heal in hand, he's an Orcanai Soul Priest draw, the second Orcanai Soul Priest draw away from being able to threaten a lot of pressure on Stan Sivka.
By the way, just to kind of digress from the game, what do you think about the Cabal Shadow Priest having his power still in game while he is still in game? So an example, if you silence the Cabal Shadow Priest, you get the minion back. Do not make it permanent.
Oh, interesting. Right, yeah, that's what you're saying.
Like, if you kill the minion, you get it back. I mean, if you kill Cabal Shadow Priest, you get the minion back. Wouldn't be too weak to play?
In its current form, I think it probably would. You'd have to maybe lower it to a 5-drop, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's an interesting idea, at least.
I mean, so the card is so oppressive, right?
It is, yeah. Of course, aspects of the classic set are being looked at now going into standard. And obviously, like, we all have our pet favorite cards that we feel like are almost certainly going to get adjusted. But I'm pretty sure Blizzard will throw a few curveballs at us as well by changing a few cards that we perhaps don't expect.
Yep.
And who knows? Ooh. Maybe Cabal Shadow Priest is one of the cards on that list.
Look at that. No Morganis.
Yeah. And he did, in fact, draw the Orcanai Soul Priest as well. So this game is actually starting to line up a little bit here for Zetalot if he can make something happen.
So I bet he was going for the draws this turn, right? With the Circle of Healing, he will attack into the 2/4. Mm-hmm. Wow. He can even draw four cards? Yes, four cards. He goes for the four cards. That's really insane valuable for him. Because now he will most likely... Wait, he switched the deck, so we have no idea if he plays double Light Bomb,
right,
double Entomb.
The double Flash Heal as well, hugely important. If he has the second one, there it is!
Oh my god! That's the Face Hunter!
Oh, Holy Champion! Pet favorite card of Zetalot's, card that he's fit in numerous times into various Control Priest decks. Very, very strangely aggressive card for a Priest deck. Card that can just instantly lose you the game if you leave it in play for one turn, and suddenly there's some Pyromancer, Power Shield, Circle of Healing nonsense, and you just die in one turn. So, Stan Sivka now is going to have to find some sort of defensive play, and the only real defensive minion that he has in hand is Mal'Ganis. He chooses not to play it. I think that's just game, Lothar.
I think so. Wow. Well, that escalated quickly.
It really did, yeah.
It's really interesting that... It's really cool to see how the deck works, because that's something we were talking for the past 20 minutes, right? How do you win the game? Because you need to cycle through the deck, get those projectiles in your hand, and just queue those up in one turn.
Absolutely. We see the difference in this game. Oh, hang on. Did we forget about the Sacrificial Pact? Is that good enough? I don't think it's good enough.
No, because he has to use the Hellfire, so he damaged. Yeah.
Yeah, this is still lethal. So I just want to point out the difference between this game and the two that we've seen previously is you kept mentioning how aggressively Stan Sivka was answering the potential card draw of the opponent. He was silencing Norsha Clerics. He was sending 8 damage Mountain Giants into Norsha Clerics. And you see exactly why in this game here. Because in this game, Zetalot was able to get the double Cleric big cycle turn, and that is the result you see right there. He builds up the Wombo combo in hand, Orcanai, double Flash Heal, Hero Power, steals the game, and Zetalot, despite the incredibly bad matchup he's facing, is now 2-2 in this series.
Yeah, so I would have to ask you, how come Zetalot didn't switch for the deck A before, right? It seems very similar, but it's more aggro orientated, right?
Right.
Because it has the Holy Champion.
Yeah.
I mean, aggro. It's not really aggro.
Aggro <It's>, priest.
Yeah. It's more bursty,
yes.
I would say. Because the Holy Champion is a threat itself. You have double options of comboing your opponent with a huge Holy Champion that will deal 800 damage in one turn. Because it is possible if you have Pyromancers in this deck too. And I guess that's probably a way of building that deck. I'm not sure I'm the priest expert. I'm sure Zetalot has that work out perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really interesting to see the reasoning. I would love to have an actual insight from the players. And I'm sure they will do some recap commentary from the players about the deck choices
sure.
after the tournament.
The one thing I can think of is maybe to make room for these Thought Steals and the Holy Champion, the extra cards that we're seeing, maybe he's playing less total copies of, say, Light Bomb and Entomb. And he felt like the first priest deck with all the answers was a better way to deal with Handlock. And when that didn't work, he's instead switched to the more aggressive play. That is not a terrible Thought Steal.
Big not at all.
And Twilight Drake picked up. That is pretty good going here from Zetalop.
Yeah, and now the powerful play of Coin Mountain Giant. We'll see, of course, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we didn't use that joke for like almost a year. I was missing that.
Also, just picking up the Big Game Hunter from the Thought Steal there is kind of interesting because he now has the information that the Big Game Hunter isn't in hand, which is useful information when you have the Holy Champion. Because sometimes you can heal your, you know, heal to make your Holy Champion too big to get it into Big Game Hunter range. But since he Thought Stole it, he knows the Big Game Hunter isn't in hand, and he can choose to be really aggressive with that Holy Champion very soon if he wants.
But he didn't go that. He didn't go for that because the Twilight Dragon will decrease in value over time. Right, yeah. He's not the Handlock. He can't really draw cards unless he combos out, and he already lost the one cleric because it got silenced right now. And this is again Stan Sivka's way of playing this matchup: just decline every possible draw engine for Zetalop, because that's how he wins the matchup, by bursting down with one mana cost cards, the health from the Warlock and second silence. I mean, it changes some stuff. It deals 5 damage. It's a kill command on a beast, basically. Like, with legs or wood.
It's a dilemma you have to face quite commonly in, say, Handlock Mirrors, when they play turn 4 Twilight Drake and you have to pick between silencing it or just playing your own big threat on turn 4 of yourself. Normally, you'd be happy to have your Mountain Giant come down to contest a Twilight Drake, but Stan Sivka here, obviously scared of the extra options Priest has to deal with that, like Shadow of Death. He's going to go with the slightly more timid play of just owling the threat from the priest and just sending this game as long as possible, because I think he'll feel like he's pretty well favored if the game goes long. But we have seen Zetalot's ability to win the long game here by building up the burst combo in hand with Orcanite Soul Priest.
Yeah, but he needs that draw engine. And he lost one cleric, he doesn't have the Acolyte of Pain. And the one he needs now is to just buy time and deal some damage with the minions on board. So let's count. How much damage does he have right now? He can... that's not enough.
No, he can.
It's on plus 4 damage, so that's 11. So he needs to entomb that. Deal some damage. This is possible 7. So he'll be at 14. You can... I would spare the attack with the second minion, because otherwise your opponent can play the Molten Giant, but at the same time he has the Big Game Hunter. But if he attacks like that, being super aggressive, that says to Stan Sivka that he has an answer to a Molten Giant, right?
Yeah, I mean, it could send that message, but also when you have Holy Champion in play, it could also just send the message of, you know, you have burst potential in your hand. You have maybe like Pyromancer and Circle of Healing or something like that. I think putting him to 14 here is fine. Like you say, he can play the Molten Giant, but he can't play Molten Giant Shadow Flame. So it would be, you know, Molten Giant with a defensive play like Sunfire Protector, etc. And if that happens, then the Big Game Hunter is obviously just a natural answer. So I think putting him to 14 is just about the perfect number. I think if it was 13, he would have passed it up, knowing that the Emperor had come down to discount cards. If Emperor discounted both Molten Giant and Shadow Flame here, then sure, you're in trouble.
Hello. Oh, my God. 3 mana. Now you can't do that. Well, you can. You can play both and... Wait, isn't he dead? No, he puts on the taunters.
Yes. So he can Big Game Hunter 1. Is he able to get the clean trade of the Holy Champion into the second giant here?
But isn't that sacrificing his win condition right now?
It is, yeah. But he doesn't have enough mana to entomb Big Game Hunter. So this is where things start to go so very quickly downhill for the priest. And these sorts of games happen so often when you're playing priest against Handlock.
That wouldn't be available to Stan Sivka if the attack from the Holy Champion would have been spared.
Right. No, that's very true.
So this is why I was thinking, like, maybe you shouldn't attack. Because you saw the Emperor. You see which cards are being used from the hand. And there's like 5 cards that weren't used for the whole game. when there were a lot of options to use Hellfire, to use practically anything to clear the board. So, oh, this doesn't look good for Zed'Alot right now.
It does not, no. Second Molten is able to come down this turn. He can choose to play it with the Loatheb, knowing that the likely answer here now is second in Tomb. Shadow of Death would be able to be cast for exactly 8 mana, take up his whole turn. But since he's trading off the board here, leaving the board empty, playing Loatheb also protects against the Orcanai Burst turns. So feel like Molten Giant Loatheb is a pretty solid turn here. It's just a question of whether you also tap. And Sifkar appears to be a brave man. He knows he's playing against Priest here. Looks like we're going to go for the zero mana Molten Giant and the Loatheb to follow it up. Unless he sees something more appealing. I mean, Voidcaller Sunfury Protector doesn't look awful either, but that does open you up to the Orcanai Soul Priest death that you've encountered several times already in this game. So,
did he use even a one-shot or death at some point? I don't think so, right?
No, I don't think so either.
Interesting.
Wow, okay. So, if the Orcanai is drawn, we do not quite have lethal. Oh, wow. Wow! And that, okay, so I come from fighting games where there's a concept of training your opponent, which is to expect a certain outcome, and then you give them, you do the other outcome, so that they, mm-hmm. you know, you train them to, you know, tech throws, and then you hit them with a counter hit, something like that. Stan Sifkar in this game has been trained to expect to die to Orcanai Soul Priest and Flash Heal, and because of that, he's literally just sacrificed a 3-drop. Just 3 mana's worth of tempo, or 2 mana since it was discounted, just threw it onto the board and threw it because of how scared he is of what's been happening to him over the last
and
couple
two
of
cards.
Not
only
and
mana,
two cards.
Two
yeah.
cards, right? But that's not, like, the amount of cards is not a problem, because in this matchup, you will have the card advantage in your hand anyway, and Jarax is a win condition on its own. So Jarax is practically like draw 5 cards.
And so the Emperor comes down here. Wait, hang on. That Emperor is in his deck, right? That's not a second thought steal or something that I've
Well, there was an Entomb on the Emperor.
Ah, right, yes, okay, so. Okay. So how are we now dealing with this Deathlord?
2 flesh heals available, but that's 10 damage.
Yep.
So
I'm not sure if we've seen Justicar from this second priest deck from Zed'Alot. It was in the priest deck that he opened with initially, but I'm not sure if we saw it in the last game. I don't think we did, and we haven't seen it drawn so far. So he may not be able to get the extra hero power damage here with the Orcanai, but the Orcanai Soul Priest draw, which there's only one of left in the deck. He played that one early onto the board on turn 4, as you commented on, Lothar. So there's only one Orcanai left in the deck, and that pretty much seems to be his win condition now.
Yeah. And it doesn't sound good.
Oh, hey.
Oh, whoa.
A spare Voidcaller. Which,
I mean, it's a 3/4 minion, doesn't die to Light Bomb.
Sure.
I guess that's good. And even if you get Light Bomb, not only you only kill one minion, but even if you would kill the whole board, you don't have an answer to Mal'Ganis. He's tapping. Now he's in range of double Flash Heal, and how can I into...
Ooh, that's one off. That is one damage
off
lethal right now.
My god. Let me change
your mind. So now how much damage is this coming back the other way? That's 12 damage plus 6 from hand. Actually, it's more damage to play the Mal'Ganis.
Yes, because Mal'Ganis adds plus 4. So that's 4, 8, 13, 16, 19. One off lethal.
Oh, hey! They're just trading one damage off lethals back and forth here, but... the Mal'Ganis is going to come down, which means he's safely able to tap here if he wants. Maintain that level of health. So unless this deck from Zed'Alot is also carrying the third burst heal card in the Light of the Naru, he may be struggling to clutch out this last bit of damage here. But the decision needs to be made from Sifkar whether he wants to tap this turn or go for the Dark Bomb to help clear out some of these minions.
Well, I think you want to clear the minions because you will draw. You will draw the Drax at some point anyway. I was thinking about the outs. Like, what are the outs for Zed'Alot right now?
He got the Big Game Hunter again.
That's something. I mean, you can use now. You can basically use your whole hand apart from in-game boss, and I think you should.
Wait.
Is it that lethal?
Big Game Hunter, Orc and I circle. Your Orc and I will live, and so will the 4-5 Cabal.
That's lethal, right?
Yeah, it's lethal. This is lethal.
My god, this is amazing. Zedalon wins against a Handlock 3 times in a best of 5. Oh my god. What a turn of events. The Falsely was the MVP. I mean, he had an option to get Sack Pack too, right? So there are two outs, and the Sack Pack would have been even better. But what an amazing game. Zed'Alad was the underdog in this matchup because it was Priest against Warlock from the beginning. But... okay, sorry, we just have... Never mind. But what a game. I'm just blown away by Zed'Alad here. Congratulations to him for winning the unfavorable matchup. What is it so unfavorable? Let's analyze this, right?
I think it is. I mean, Zed'Alad, you know, as things like Light Bomb and Entomb have come into the game, you've had more chances. As Flash Heal has come into the game as well, you've had a chance to actually generate some burst damage. But it's very, very unfavorable, for sure, still. But Zed'Alad correctly identified his outs. He was aggressive from the get-go. He was passing up trades to deal more face damage. He was playing minions out that, you know, potentially have value in the long term, like Cleric, like Wild Pyromancer, just to push extra damage to face early on. And then during the mid-game turn, once he'd established that little bit of damage early on, that's when he'd take his time to slow down and cycle, because at that point you can play the game from behind and just threaten the Priest Burst from hand. So Zed'Alad played the games really, really well. Definitely taught me a thing or two about how to, you know, scrap a few wins out of that matchup, but hugely unfavored. I mean, Zeta, if it wasn't already confirmed, Zeta best Priest confirmed.
Yeah, an awesome game to see. Like, I really was hoping that this will be the case in the one class tournament. Like, we will see those rivalries, right? Between the antagonist classes, because that's what it is, right? And it's really cool to see that even the underdog wins. And as you said, Zed'Alad played, I think, almost perfectly. There maybe was like one decision that I would question, and that was the attack with the Holy Champion.
Right.
And that's basically it. But everything else was practically insanely well played by Zed'Alad. But of course, we have the full information when players don't, right? Yep. So we have an easier job to do. But congratulations to Zed'Alad. He advances to the top 8, so he's already in cash. And unfortunately for Stan Sivka, that's the end of the road because it's a single elimination tournament. But I will be casting 7 more matches today, and we will have a short break for 5 minutes. We'll have the next pair ready for the game, and we'll be right back. This is the G2 Esports Class Legends. Be sure to hashtag it on Twitter with the hashtag G2CL, so you will be also shown on screen if you have anything interesting to say about the tournament. Don't go anywhere, we'll be right back.